In this video, a STEM innovator and computer scientist, Kenyatta Goins, drops in to volunteer his time to speak to a group of young people who are learning to code for the first time. This video captures most of their conversation. Enjoy.
Congratulations for doing that. When I think back to my first introduction to computers, I was in about the eighth or ninth grade, and my aunt gave me an old Tandy computer that wouldn't boot up. So I began being a natural tinkerer. I started working towards getting it to work. There was no commercial internet, so I had to go to the library every day, and I found a book on Microsoft DOS,
which recording is in progress.
One of the first Microsoft operating systems, and I learned all the commands that I would need to get it up and running. After about a week and a half or so, I was able to get it going. And this led to me taking basic and a few other computer-related vocational classes in high school before going to college to study computer science. So the two biggest takeaways from my early experience are the two biggest tools that you will need to flourish as computer scientist. And that is the ability to do research and an aptitude for problem solving. If you got those two tools in your tool belt, no matter which facet of computer science you decide to make your career, you're gonna do great. So that said, I'll go ahead and pause here and take any questions you have.
Do you use anything besides JavaScript for like your backend development?
Well, I'm about 15 years removed from actually coding. Now I'm in disaster recovery. So I lead a team of coders along with system server administrators, network engineers, and I bring those folks together to solve major incidents. Prior to that, I was in project management where I led a team of software developers. Prior to that, I was a network engineer, and prior to that, I coded. So that's just to give you an idea that computer science is a very diverse discipline, and that's one degree that you can take it, and you can use it to get to go anywhere in IT.
Okay. Do you use Python?
No, actually, I don't. Like I said, I haven't done coding for a long, long time. Here's the thing about computer science. So when I first got in there, the technology was doubling about every 10 months. The languages I first learned are obsolete. Oh. Pascal, C and C++ is legacy. Java, a lot of new applications still use that as a basis. So C++ is still relevant. But then there was COBOL, Fortran. It was a good number of languages that I was proficient in, but that I don't need anymore. And right now, the flavor of the times is Python and a few others. Give it about 10, 15 years, there'll be other languages. So the thing about it, if you're going to be in coding, you're going to be constantly learning new languages. Excuse me.
How flexible would you say that the work is you do? Like, is it flexible with your schedule? Are you able to just go out and do other things and not having to worry about having something by a set deadline? Or?
Yes. And that's why I'm in the field. That's why I'm in the area that I'm in now, because it's one where I can put family first and work second. Like, that's an ideal situation. You don't want to have to sacrifice your life so that you can work and make good money. The good thing about computer science is that you have to have a fondness for technology, and it pays well. So yeah, when you first, that's really going to be dependent upon the company you work for, whether you work for yourself. That's going to depend upon those things that are deadline driven. But for me, I've chosen to go into more of a leadership role. So no, I can, it's very, very flexible for me. I work from home 4 days out of the week. I go in the office 1 day a week. And that's optional. So if I need to go to the Bahamas tomorrow, I could do so. So it's very flexible. But again, that's going to be dependent upon your role at XYZ company. That makes sense.
I have a question. Like, how is like teamwork? Like how do you like integrate your like ideas? Like now I know like you're like the manager and also like when you were coding, like does that make sense?
Yeah. That's a very, very good question. Cause it is a team driven discipline. You could code it all by yourself. It's going to take you a while. So any software project that you get involved with, whether it's building video games or developing some new app that does something great on your phone, it's a lot of code. And so you're going to have to work with a team of people that may have different specialties. You know, you may be great at graphics, but someone else may be great at doing other things. And so you want to let them handle the graphics and, you know, well, you handle the graphics and they handle other aspects of the project. So it's a very team-oriented discipline, and you're going to have to be able to work with others. Well, how do you do that? It's the same way you interact with your peers in school. You network, you talk with them, you meet regularly, daily, and you talk through the project.
Okay. One of my questions is, do you use a drive to hold your data? And what kind of drive do you use?
Good question. I use several methods for holding my data. I got old school hard drives that I use to, well, they're solid state, they're not that old. And I also back it up in the cloud. I made the mistake once of not having it backed up in the cloud, and that solid state drive that's not supposed to go out like the old school hard drives went out. So you always want to make sure you've got your data backed up to where you can get access to it.
Do you think that knowing computer hardware would be really beneficial when also understanding computer software?
Absolutely. Like I said, I got my start in on the hardware, which is now called desktop systems, desk side systems. That's where I first started, was doing that. And when I was a freshman in college, I worked at this place, they're no longer in business, PC Warehouse, and they custom built computers. And this was at a time before you couldn't just order it online or, you know, run into Walmart and pick one up. And they were very expensive then. And we custom built computers. And I got my A+ certification, which is something else I wanted to touch on, is that there are multiple pathways to achieving a career in IT. You have the degree path, which is through college and universities, and you also have a certificate program path. So depending on what you wanted to do or how you want to move around in IT, you have multiple pathways. Now, the computer science pathway, there's only one, and that's through college. But the biggest plus for going that route is that you can take that computer science degree, and no matter what IT field is, and some outside of IT, that's because computer science is a math intensive discipline. So you can take that degree and you can work in a lot of fields outside of IT. So it's if you go now and look at people that are hiring for any IT job, they may be asking for, let's just say, a network engineer, but they also, you don't have any network experience, but you got a computer science degree, you can, they'll hire you first. So that's the biggest pro to me, is that it's a very, very high demand career.
Do you use codes from other websites?
Do I use code from other websites? You mean like copy and pasting?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Well, I did. Copying and pasting. This is now, you actually have apps that's what they do. You don't have to actually do all of your coding. You can copy and paste certain actions or certain aspects of a program directly from other cookie cutter type programs. So yeah, absolutely, I would, if I was working on a if I was coding something, I would certainly copy and paste or use code from other websites. Now, that said, you're still going to have to compile it and make sure that it works. So you're still going to have to know your stuff, even though you're copying and pasting. You're still going to have to know your stuff in order to ensure that
it works.
The code is doing what you want it to do.
At what point does it become like plagiarism? Like, is there a line where you can copy code and it's like, okay, that's fine? Or, and then is there a line where it's like, okay, that is not fine?
Well, if you copy it, if it's intellectual property, that means someone has taken this application and took all the necessary steps to copyright it, trademark it. Okay, now that's plagiarism. But your code, the way your system languages are developed, it's a series of functions. And these series of functions, used in such a way via your algorithm, you get software to do what it is that you want it to do. So certain functions, no matter how they're written, are just functions.
Yeah.
So you copy that, that little isolated piece, you know, it can't be plagiarized. But like I said, if it's Microsoft Word, you copy that verbatim, yeah, you're gonna have some problems. But for the most part, you can pull out, you know, because there's some, like I said, it's one part problem solving, and there are some brilliant people who have come up with very creative ways to create functionality within software. So I would say verbatim, the entire project is plagiarism, but a function here and there should be just fine.
I have a question. How is like deadline stress? Like, are you ever feel like rushed? Like,
yeah, that's going to be dependent upon the project that you're working on. It's going to be dependent upon the company you work for, whether you work for yourself, freelance or what have you. It's going to be dependent on that, because I have been in situations where I took the work home, got up in the morning, and went back to work with it. You know, it took that kind of dedication and effort to get the results that we needed to get by the date that we promised we would get it. So, you know, you have situations like that. I don't do that anymore. Now, when I go home, I leave the work and I see it when I get back tomorrow. You know, I may get a call here or there to make a decision on something, but that's going to depend on the project that you're working on. You know, because, you know, there are projects that are in the millions and billions of dollars. And you're developing something if you're developing software for, say, EA Sports, right, they got a deadline where they want to get that stuff out so their marketing teams can get a hold of it and sell this stuff. This is million dollar projects. So something like that, yeah, you may have to put in you know, extra time to get it done. But, you know, the good thing about that is you get out of it what you put into it. And that applies to not only the projects that you work on with computer science, but also applies to life. Whatever you put into a thing, that's typically what you get out of it. You know, so that said, you can make a lot of money. Yeah, you can live that, you know, you can live that lifestyle. So, you know, that's the reward for the work that you put in.
Thank you.
I got a question for you. All right, so you live in Memphis, Tennessee, which is a pretty large city. How important is it to live in a major city when you're a programmer or coder?
Back in the days, it was very important. I left Jackson because there was no opportunities there for computer scientists. There were plenty entry-level desktop-type jobs, but I didn't invest in a degree so that I could do those, because I could have just went and got a certification and got those jobs. So I left Memphis because of that, but we don't live in that time anymore. We live in a time now where everything is interconnected via teleconference, just like we're doing right now. We don't even have to be in the same room, and we can communicate, we can share work through Microsoft Teams and a bunch of other applications that specialize in doing that. So no, you don't have to do that anymore. I had a project that I was developing years ago, and it was for my personal use. It was an app that I was developing. And my team were mainly in China and India.
Oh,
and so, you know, that time has passed. You guys live in the information age, and you guys are coming up right around the time where you live doesn't matter. You can be in a cornfield in Kansas, or you can be in New York City, and you can still get the opportunities and do the work. Now, that said, there are areas that are more advantageous than others. If you were in, say, Silicon Valley, right, you're going to have more opportunities than you would in Memphis, Tennessee. But that's not to say that you would be restricted from building a career in computer science by not being in California.
So basically what you're saying is, let's say you're to be a Mississippi. Could you like get hired in a job that's in another state?
Yeah. So when you go out and you look at various opportunities, you'd notice that a lot of companies don't require you to be local to where they are. Matter of fact, a lot of those companies aren't even in the U.S. or U.S. based. So there are opportunities out there where, yeah, you could be in Mississippi and do well. And they would hire you because most of your work is going to be done just like we're doing now. So it's all about your skill set. If you have a skill set that they need, they're not going to just limit themselves to who's in the 20-mile radius when they don't really need them to touch nothing or be in a 20-mile radius. So those opportunities will be out there as well. But again, there are opportunities. You know, it can be more advantageous to be in an area where they're throwing up a company's coming in and building their headquarters and they're going to need a team. It will be advantageous to be in that area. Yeah. But again, that shouldn't restrict you from getting opportunities.
Another question. Do you hire coders? And if you do, what do you look for when you hire coders?
Yeah, so most of my team now is matrix to me. So we have a department that is application development, and it's all developers. We have a department that is telecommunications, and it's all network and telecommunication engineers. So all these folks are matrix to me. So I don't hire off the street. I pull from a pool of people that have already been vetted. But what I do look for, though, because I have had engineers come to me and they are not as knowledgeable, And I've had those, of course, that come and I don't even have to say anything. They already know what to do. But the one thing that they have in common is an aptitude for learning. Right? As long as you're flexible in terms of your growth and your ability to learn fast, you know, the experience, the knowledge, all that comes. So that's what I look for in a teammate. But in terms of hiring off the street, I do work with our HR department, and I know what they look for. And they look for people who has, in IT-wise, the paperwork that backs up their education. And that is, you got, well, the paperwork that backs up their experience, which is computer science is always the number one field that they look for.
Do you have any other questions? No, actually, you answered. All right, all the questions asked. All right, Mr. Goins, thank you very much for joining us today. Guys, give Mr. Goins a round of applause. Baby.
Thank you. All right.
The advice is
much appreciated.
Yeah, very appreciated. All right, take care, man.
All right, man. Y'all have a good one.
Mr. Mr.